My name is Guy de la Bedoyer, British historian and writer, and as those of you who are familiar with this channel will be aware, I've uploaded quite a few videos in recent months concerned with Egyptology, and that's been thanks to the research I've done on this book that I wrote, published in July 2022 in the UK, called Pharaohs of the Sun, A History of Tutankhamun's Dynasty, the 18th Dynasty. And I've also just recently been to Egypt, and I've been uploading some of my photographs. This video is going to be another in that series. What I've chosen for this one, and don't get too excited, there aren't going to be too many more of these because I couldn't photograph everything, and some things are very familiar. But this one probably isn't. This is the chariot body of Thutmose IV. Now, Thutmose IV was the father of Amenhotep III, who is the probable grandfather of Tutankhamun. Thutmose IV did not live a very long time. He probably died around the age of 30 at the most. His mother was a woman called Tia, and this is one of those peculiarities. You have statues of Thutmose IV with his mother Tia as if she was his wife. Indeed, she had the title Great Royal Wife, and this is part of the political manipulation, if you like, of the dynastic history, in which, thanks to Hatshepsut, the queen who made herself into a king, several of her successors made sure that their wives were completely marginalised from public life and monuments during their lifetimes, or during the king's lifetimes. They only appear usually as the mother of the next king, but as the great royal wife. So that is how she appears. Thutmose IV was also married, was actually married to Mutanwir, who was the mother of Amenhotep III. Thutmose IV's mummy is in the National Museum of Egyptian Civilization, along with all the other great royal mummies from the Keshe, well, most of them actually. Amenhotep III wasn't on display, for example. His mummy is remarkably memorable for its serene expression. And it's remarkably lifelike, actually, and I will put a photograph, one of the photographs taken in the 1880s, late 19th century anyway, on this video. You can't actually take photographs of them today. Now, the chariot was found in the tomb, which was discovered just after the turn of the 20th century by Howard Carter, working for Theodore Davis at the time, and it was found in the burial chamber. Tutankhamun had a number of chariots in his tomb, which are very famous because they were essentially complete. They'd been dismantled, but they were there with their axles and their wheels and all their fittings. Now, Thutmose IV's chariot is not like that at all. It's just the body. There are bits and pieces left there. In fact, the tomb had quite a lot of broken up bits and pieces found scattered around inside it, clearly indicators that it must have been a very, very grand memorial originally, a repository of his stuff, but it had been badly robbed out. It's just unusual in the sense that there were quite a few bits and pieces, and for some reason the chariot had been left behind. Now, publication by Theodore Davis is available, or certainly was available relatively recently, as a reprint, so you can actually read all about it, as it were, and there is the plan of the tomb. And that's the burial chamber, and it was found in there next to one of the columns, not very far away from the sarcophagus. And I'll just read the first bit of what Percy Newbury says here in this description. The tomb of Thutmose IV is cut out of the living rock beneath one of the limestone cliffs which line the eastern side of the valley of Biben el Muluk at Thebes. And he means the Valley of the Kings, of course. That's the Arabic name for it. It's known today as KV43. Now, if I flick through the book here to page 26, I come to the description of the chariot. I'm just going to read a few bits and pieces, but before I do that, I just want to say it was, as far as I was concerned during my recent trip, the most remarkable single object that I saw. And I knew what it looked like, but I had no idea what to expect. It was quite clearly far more impressive than I'd anticipated, and I saw that straight away. I saw it from a distance, walked straight up to it. Astonishing thing is, There was no caption, no label. I really couldn't believe that, but that's true of quite a lot of the objects in that museum. They either don't have captions or they have very vague captions. In a few cases, they have very fulsome captions, and you would have thought the chariot body of Thutmose IV would have been one of the most important things there, but not actually. So I listened to one guide telling her clients, just a couple of people who clearly expensively paid for her time, that it was the chariot of Thutmose III. And it manifestly isn't. It carries Thutmose IV's throne name, and which is Menkheperure. Thutmose III's is Menkheperre, for example. So it's very, it is very, well, in any case, it was found in Thutmose IV's tomb. So I'm just going to read some of the description here. And it says, the body of the chariot is composed of a wood framework and panelling, the latter being covered with a canvas base for stucco, which is modelled with scenes and ornamentations in very low relief. The scenes consist of four panels, two inside and two outside, divided by an exceedingly decorative and ornamental design. And if we look at those pictures there, that's the outside. You won't be able to see anything on the video from that. And that's the inside. And it is totally remarkable to think that Thutmose IV had clearly driven this along. Now, we have a number of drawings in here by Howard Carter, who was a simply superb draftsman, and I'm going to include that one in the video for you. And there are various other photographs in here and more description. And what it explains is what you have here is Thutmose IV pulverizing his Asiatic enemies, and they're very clearly Asiatic in the Egyptian way of representing them as a motif. They've all bearded, their hairstyles are particularly significant. There are at least two distinct tribes, distinguished by their appearance, but they're clearly Asiatics. Now, the key thing is that this is just another in these remarkable pharaonic images of Egypt, the king being the triumphant hero over Egypt's enemies. And it's always the same thing. The king is the embodiment of order. There he is, churning along in his chariot. He is accompanied only by the god of war, Montu, who is standing behind him. Of course, that would have been very difficult for Thutmose in reality to have ridden in a chariot while firing off arrows and smiting people with his mace, and at the same time maintaining control of his chariot. So you do have to bear in mind right from the outset that this is essentially a rhetorical image. It's symbolic. If you look at his face, it's totally impassive, apart from that serene half-Thutmosid smile, which you see on the sky. Sculpture of the same period. He's just looking like that, absolutely impassively, across a scene of total chaos on the battlefield. All his enemies, who have chariots themselves, they're being churned up, pulverized, knocked left, right and centre. Their limbs are all askew, akimbo. It's a classic Egyptian scene. And what they're telling you here is that the pharaoh is the embodiment of order, Maat. He is therefore triumphant over the forces of chaos, symbolised by the Asiatic enemies, who are being quite literally trampled underfoot. They are disordered, bewildered, confused. They're being smited, killed, knocked about, and Thutmose IV just rides above them. It's a remarkable piece of work, and I'm not sure whether it would have been luridly painted at the time. I'm not clear about that. Nevertheless, and it's probably been quite heavily restored, but it is still absolutely startling. I took quite a number of photographs, and I'm going to put them up here for you. So I hope you find this all of great interest. I should add, of course, there is the interior, and there is the pharaoh as a sphinx in one of the other drawings inside. You can see that there. And without further ado, I'll now pass you over to the pictures. I've run them at about 20 seconds each so that you can take your time looking at them. I was not able to photograph every part of it. Because the chariot is curved and because of the lighting in the museum, it's quite difficult to get really good views over all of it. Nevertheless, I hope the images will be things that you'll find very memorable, very interesting, and not something that you are really going to find photographs of in almost any Egyptology book. Okay, thank you very much.